physical examination, inspection, blood pressure and palpation, general examination and inspection. A true general examination, including a fundoscopic examination, should always be performed, and signs of other comorbidities such as cirrhosis, obstructive lung disease or stroke sought. Attention to patients' dentition is of major importance, in particular in patients with the valve disease or for those undergoing preoperative evaluation. Visible pulsations should be noted with respect to location and origin, arterial versus venous. Details regarding the non-cardiovascular and eye examinations are, however, beyond the scope of this chapter. Our patient population is aging, and frailty assessment should also be included as part of the physical examination. Gait speed, 15 feet walk, hand grip strength and muscle wasting should be recorded. Multiple scores have also been developed. This assessment should be a standard part of clinical evaluation and should be performed in patients undergoing catheter-based interventions or surgical treatment. Several syndromes have been associated with cardiovascular disease, including aortopathies, congenital heart disease, or even cardiac tumors. Careful inspection of the faces, body habitus, and extremities are necessary in order to suspect the presence of a syndrome. Although these syndromes are rare, their identification can lead to the initial suspicion of the cardiac diagnosis, which may have life-saving implications for patients and their families. Some of these findings are illustrated in Table 11.4. This table shows genetic syndromes and associated physical examination findings. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. The physical examination findings are joint hypermobility, scoliosis, legs, thin skin, variable according to disease type. Cardiovascular features include arterial aneurysms, mitral valve prolapse, Fabry disease, Fabry. The physical examination findings angiokeratomas. Cardiovascular features, infiltrative cardiomyopathy, may resemble hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, conduction abnormalities. Holt Oram, upper limb deformity due to aplasia or hypoplasia or radial and carpal bones. The cardiovascular disease are congenital heart defects, most commonly atrial septal defect and ventricular septal defect. Lois Dietz, there is hypertelorism, bifid uvula, dolichocephaly, anophthalmas, down-slanting palpebral fissures, retrognathia, pectus carinatum, arachnodactyly, increased arm span. The cardiovascular features associated with Lord's disease are aortopathy, vasculopathy, mitral valve prolapse. Marfan syndrome. There is increased height, pectus excavatum, dolichocephaly, high arch palate, flat feet, increased arm span, arachnodactyly, thumb and wrist signs. The cardiovascular system malformation presence are aortopathy, mitral valve prolapse. Noonan syndrome. There is short stature, strabismus, low set ears, low hairline, shield-shaped chest, hypertelorism. There will be presence of pulmonary valve stenosis, atrial septal defect, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Turner syndrome, short stature, webbed neck, cubitus valgus. The cardiovascular manifestation, bicuspid aortic valve, aortopathy, aortic coarctation. Williams syndrome, Elfin face with broad forehead, short nose, wide mouth, flat nasal bridge. Cardiovascular features include supravalvular aortic stenosis, branch pulmonary artery stenosis. Now, blood pressure measurement, blood pressure technique. Although vital signs are frequently recorded by the ancillary staff prior to the encounter with the provider, we recommend that the measurements be repeated during physical examination by the clinician. This prevents abnormalities to be missed due to time constraints and also forces the examiner to certify that all the necessary steps for the measurement of blood pressure have been done. Example, that both arms are checked. This is particularly important during the patient's initial evaluation. Blood pressure should be measured at rest. A common mistake is to measure it immediately after the patients have just walked into the room and the appropriate cuff size used. The width of the inflatable bladder should correspond to 40% of the arm's circumference. Smoking and caffeine should be avoided prior to measurement of the blood pressure. During initial assessment, blood pressure should be measured in both arms. Differences in systolic blood pressure between arms are typically less than or equal to 20 mm mercury, usually higher in the right arm. This is mandatory step prior to bypass surgery and in patients with internal mammary clots who present with angina. A simple blood pressure check might be sufficient to diagnose subclavian stenosis. Additional steps should be taken according to the clinical scenario. In patients complaining of syncope or presyncope, measurements in the supine, sitting, and standing positions must be performed. Systolic blood pressure should not fall more than 20 mm mercury on standing. Diastolic blood pressure typically rises. Mild reflex tachycardia is common, but rates above 100 beats per minute should not be expected. Newly hypertensive patients or patients with known bicuspid valve. Patients with known bicuspid valve should have blood pressure measured in the lower extremity since coarctation of the aorta might be present. A large cuff should be applied to the patient's thigh and the popliteal artery auscultated. Alternatively, a smaller cuff can be applied to cuff and a stethoscope applied to the dorsalis pedis artery. Normally, the lower extremity blood pressure tends to be 10 to 20 mm mercury higher than in the upper extremities. Digital blood pressure cuffs have been shown to be reliable and accurate in most situations. However, major abnormalities might be missed if manual blood pressure measurement is not performed. Digital blood pressure cuffs may not be accurate in assessing pulse pressure in patients with aortic regurgitation or high output states. The digital cuffs will not be able to determine the presence of a pulsus paradox or pulsus alternans. Therefore, we recommend that manual blood pressure measurement should always be performed with the stethoscope's diaphragm applied to the brachial artery, the ipsilateral radial pulse is palpated, and the cuff inflated to 20 to 30 mm mercury above the level required to obliterate the pulse. The cuff should be then deflated slowly. Systolic blood pressure corresponds to the appearance of cough sounds, phase 1, and diastolic blood pressure to the level where the cough sounds entirely disappear, phase 5. In some patients, the cough sounds might disappear and become audible again at lower pressures, that is the auscultatory gap. This is a common finding in elderly patients. And simultaneous palpation of the radial artery while the cuff is inflated prevents underestimation of the blood pressure. In hypertensive patients, Kirchhoff sounds might not be audible. Blood pressure should be determined by palpation of the radial artery. In hypertensive patients, Kirchhoff sounds might not be audible. Blood pressure should be determined by palpation of the radial artery. Heart rate and the cardiac rhythm, irregularly irregular, should also be recorded. Other vital signs, temperature and respiratory rate, and their abnormalities should be noted. Now, blood pressure abnormalities, pulse pressure. The difference between systolic and diastolic blood pressure levels should be noted. A narrow pulse pressure is seen in shock and hypotension. The arterial pulse usually shows low amplitude. A wide pulse pressure is seen in hypertension, commonly in the elderly, due to non-compliant arteries. Severe aortic regurgitation is secondary to lower diastolic blood pressure or arteriovenous shunting, such as patent ductus arteriosus or dialysis fistula. Pulsus alternans corresponds to beat-to-beat changes in systolic blood pressure or the intensity of Korotkov sounds themselves. This can be detected by auscultation and by palpation, during which time the patient should be instructed to breathe calmly. Pulsus alternans is a sign of severe left ventricular systolic dysfunction. This figure shows pulsus alternans in a patient with severe left ventricular systolic dysfunction. Invasive aortic pressure tracing and left ventricular outflow tract pulsed wave Doppler showing marked beat-to-beat reduction of in left ventricular stroke volume. Here this diagram shows left ventricular outflow tract pulsed wave Doppler. And it is the invasive aortic pressure tracing. This is the invasive aortic pressure tracing graph. Now, pulsus paradoxus corresponds to respirophasic changes in blood pressure. So, pulsus paradoxus corresponds to respirophasic changes in blood pressure. Paradox is a misnomer because minor drops in blood pressure with inspiration are normal. In pathologic situation, there is an exaggeration of this phenomenon. Normally, systolic blood pressure should not fall more than 10 mm mercury on inspiration. Normally, systolic blood pressure should not fall more than 10 mm mercury on inspiration. The presence of pulses is a subtle finding and requires the proper technique is applied. The examiner should inflate the blood pressure cuff 15 to 20 mm mercury above the systolic blood pressure, determined by palpation and auscultation. The cuff is then slowly deflated and the Korotkov sounds auscultated while the patient breathes normally. The sounds will show respirophasic changes decreasing or disappearing with inspiration. Eventually, those respirophasic changes will not be noticeable, and expiratory and inspiratory Korotkov sounds will have similar intensities. The pulses will be the difference between the peak systolic blood pressure levels measured during expiration and inspiration, and more than 10 mm mercury is abnormal. Pulsus paradoxus is classically described as a sign of cardiac tamponade or constrictive pericarditis due to the enhancement ventricular interdependence seen on those two entities. With inspiration, right ventricular stroke volume increases while left ventricular stroke volume falls. This is secondary to pericardial restraint. Pulsus paradoxus can also be seen in morbid obesity and in lung disease as a result of major changes in intrathoracic pressures. Here this figure shows pulsus paradoxus in a patient with cardiac tamponade. Invasive aortic pressure tracing is in upper figure and left ventricular outflow tract pulse wave Doppler. This is the left ventricular outflow tract pulse wave Doppler in a patient with cardiac tamponade. With pulsus paradoxus in a patient with cardiac tamponade, with simultaneous respirometer tracing confirm marked decrease in left ventricular stroke volume with inspiration. And this tracing shows left ventricular, this is the invasive aortic pressure tracing. This is the invasive aortic pressure tracing in pulses paradoxus in a patient with cardiac tamponade.